Future
flavors.
Yo, what is the deal? Shout out to all the grateful ones at the crib watching, tuning in. I appreciate y'all. We live at Women 107.3, Pittsburgh's number one for hip hop. It's your boy, Cold Blooded. I got very special guests in the building. Knew this dude for a while. You know what I'm saying? Like a really long time. Like before the good Seffy, the Uncle Seffy, all of that stuff. Before seeing him turn up in the crazy parties and doing all the stuff that he's doing. But nonetheless, we got Seth. What should I just say him all? We got Seth to death, good Seffy.
Say him all,
Uncle
man.
Seffy. Say we got all. Seth. I don't know your last name, but
Thompson,
Mr. Seth.
Seth
Thompson.
We got Seth Thompson, yeah. Seffy De Niro.
Mr. T, Seffy De Niro.
Mr. T, Seth.
Seth.
It's Seth. Like,
you got Seth in the building. What's up, Seth?
What's
how you feeling?
I'm good.
You looking very clean. So you got the shape up. You got the LV on. You know what I'm saying? I really like them balances right there. Them is
bro.
Very comfortable.
Bro, these balances, bro. I'm going to tell you about these balances.
Tell me about them. Which ones are they? What number?
Bro, they are. They are the.
You got the camera on the shoes.
Yeah, you already know. You already know.
I think they said AZ600, something like that. I don't really know numbers. Like when it comes to new balances,
right.
I just know just retros and just, you know, color coordinates of the balances. Like, you feel me? Like these, I walked into Jimmy J's in Monrovia.
Okay.
I'm saying, you know how you just walk in the shoe store, you know what I'm saying? You just browse and whatnot, mm-hmm. right?
As soon as you walk in, as soon as you take a breath, can you need some help?
Bro, I said, I turned to the left.
Yeah.
I was like, oh yeah, I need them.
Right.
10.5
right now.
They said, oh yeah, we got a 10.5 and 11. I said, bring both of them. Just so I can see if they fit.
I'm trying to be like you, man. You know what I'm saying? What's up with your glasses? What are those?
Man, look, these is the, I don't even know what to call these, man. These is just the,
Bust them down 3,000.
These are the
bust them down.
No, these are the Monrovia Mall Buffies.
Monrovia Mall Buffies. Hey, he's keeping it real. Where you getting them at?
I'm keeping a buck.
Where you getting
right
them?
Right across from Finish Line, the kiosks.
Right the kiosks
with the Arabs. I'm telling you.
With the
40 bucks. 40 bucks.
40 cash,
bro.
That's nice.
Bro, Scoop. Shout out to Scoop. Low.
Shout out to Scoop. Bro, I got a pair of those.
Bro, Scoop. Hello.
Yeah.
On everything, bro. Like his. I think. Don't let me get the line, but you know what I'm saying, some of his inventory definitely come from Monrovia Mall.
You think so?
I think so. He might.
Scoop.
I don't know.
Scoop.
He might. Look,
Scoop
might get another vendor.
Scoop.
I'm not hating on him, but look, because Scoop is my man's. Scoop is my man's.
Yeah.
100 grand, you feel me? He done took off. He done moved his life to Houston, and he created another legacy in another state, another city.
Shout out to Scoop. Look.
Applaud to him. You feel me? But them Scoop Ellos, them is definitely some, yeah, Monrovia Mall Ellos. For real.
It's not funny, but it is.
No, but bro, it's like, look.
Yeah.
People gotta understand, it's like, look, your business, you can make your business out of anything. It doesn't matter what it is. Like, with hair, people get their hair off of vendors from these online sites and resell them.
Absolutely.
You know what I'm saying? Like, they re-deep condition the hair. You know what I'm saying, like reboiling them and stuff like that. You know, you see the little TikTok tutorials and stuff like
mm-hmm.
that. But, you know, everybody has their own thing. Like,
mm-hmm.
but it's just, you know, it takes a gimmick. You got to have a gimmick.
Yeah, shout out to Ebony at the crib, showing people how to wash their money, going viral. Not illegally, but,
yo,
you know what I'm saying? You know what I mean? Shout out to her.
I might have to take her up on that because I might have to wash money.
What, man, what are you being? All right.
I might have to wash some cash. Right,
cut that.
And then, you know, just as time went on, like started rapping when I was like really first recorded my song, first song when I was 12.
Yeah.
In my uncle's basement.
Yeah.
On the West End.
Okay.
So, and then from that point on, it was just, you know, like everybody in my family, you know, like how family, you know, is supposed to motivate you when you're young and stuff
mm-hmm.
like that, you know what I'm saying? Just keep your head on straight.
Put the battery in.
You know, but me personal, I was just, you know, like I kind of caught on early.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I was doing talent shows when I was young.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, and it's like, people don't know.
You had stage fright?
No, I didn't. All right,
keep going.
I didn't. Like, people don't know. It's like, when, before all the, you know, the school closings and everything like that, like, you know, you remember William Penn, right?
I was a Pennhead kid. I went from East Hills to
oh,
Pennhead.
Oh, yeah, that is right. You went, yeah.
And then you had, like, Shenandoah,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Washington, I think, Dibble,
right.
All that. Yeah, like, all, like,
yeah.
The 5-6 other schools.
Right. And then, like, because there came a time where all the elementary schools closed.
Yeah.
And the only elementary schools was open was Penn Hebron, Washington, and Forbes.
I forgot. Yeah, Forbes. Yeah,
so,
yeah.
So, you know, like...
Penn Hill School District, by the
Penn
way.
Penn Hill School District, by the way, you know. But, like, yeah. So, William Penn, Like, I first, second, third grade.
Mm-hmm.
You know, got kicked out third grade. You know what I'm saying? Because somebody wanted to have, you know, the same jacket as me back then, right? And they was just getting into all types of trouble. And we, look, we rode the same bus together, bro. We rode the same bus.
You sure this ain't you?
Bro, this is, was not me.
It was not you.
It was not me. Lied, bro. Strike me dead right now. It was not me. But anyway.
Same
so
jacket.
I got kicked out of Penn Hebron, kicked out of William Penn.
Right.
Went to Penn Hebron that following year in the fourth grade.
Yeah.
You know, so... That's where, you know, I met, like, you know, a whole bunch of people. Met a whole bunch of people that I know today. Like, you know, we grew up together. Type tip. You know, then I didn't know that elementary schools had basketball teams, right? Mm-hmm. As soon as I got to Penn Hebron, it was a whole basketball league.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah,
and everybody in the school was playing against each other. Fourth, third, like second, third, fourth, fifth graders, everybody was playing against each other.
Yeah.
So I'm like, oh, yeah, this is where I need to be at. But the only thing that sucked about that was we had to wear uniforms. We were the only elementary school that wore uniforms back then.
What, so the other schools, you
other
got
schools
to just dress
not,
up,
yes,
however?
Yes, however. But we had to wear uniforms. And it was just, you know, it was like it sucked.
You couldn't have your own drip as a kid,
no.
Pretty much. You couldn't come out with the all-white Buffies dunking on people in fourth grade.
No, bro. And it's like... Marv with the pinhead,
Shout out to Marv behind the camera.
Come on, man, Marv, no. But.
Your shoe game had to be right, though.
Bro, yeah, your shoe game had to
that's,
be right,
that's
bro.
That's why the uniforms
were
impressive.
That's what it was. That's what it was.
Mm-hmm.
And that's back when the Air Force Jordans first dropped.
Air Force Jordans.
Bro.
I had some Jordans growing up, but by the time I made it to Penn Hebron.
Hey, y'all remember the Fusions?
Yeah, the Fusions. The Fusions. That's what them called. That's what they called. The Fusions. That's what they called. They had an all white and black pair. First came out, everybody grabbed them. Like, if you ain't had them.
I had Starburys.
Facts, I had a pair of Starburys.
I had like three pairs of Starburys. I started skateboarding by then. I had DC's, Vans.
Bro.
I had like a black pair of like infrareds, like Spizzix. I think that's what they were, number five. Right?
Spizzix,
I think I had some
yeah.
of them. I think I had some taxis. But by the time I got to Penn Hebron, I wasn't as fresh by comparison, let's say.
Bro, the Fusions, like, bro, if you ain't have a Fusion, bro, if you ain't had no Fusions, or no Forces.
Mm-hmm.
Like, look, the Fusions were high top Forces mixed with the Taxi 12s.
Were they black and gold?
Yes, they had.
They had the little air
yeah,
aglet.
Exactly.
That's what I had.
Yep.
They weren't Taxis. That was Fusions.
Yep, those were Fusions. Facts. Everybody had Fusions, and then that's when they came up with the girl colorway Fusion. They had
the Fusion. The Fusions. Oh, I felt like the man with them.
Bro, if you had the Fusions on, bro,
you
could get anybody.
Yeah.
But yeah, you know, that's just basically what it was, and then you know, uniform things suck, bro. Like, we had a dress down day, bro, probably like every Friday,
like
one Friday out of every 2 months, like, you know what I mean? And then it would just be like,
it was still trash.
Still trash.
Like, I only get fresh on one Friday.
we get fresh freaking one Friday out of every 2-3 months. Like,
by that time, my whole wardrobe was almost uniform. So I was like, what am I gonna get fresh with?
And the only time that people saw you outside of your regular clothes, they saw you outside of school.
Yeah,
which
a lot of times, you know, you children, so
exactly.
You don't really go beyond your block.
Exactly.
So,
right.
There
unless
you go.
Unless, like, you know, people that you friends with, you know,
mm-hmm.
y'all live on the same block, y'all live around the same little neighborhood,
mm-hmm.
same little street, whatever like that. But back then, you know, everybody was
mm-hmm.
on that. Either you was over there or you were over there. Like, if you were over there by, you know, by Dairy Queen and all that stuff like that.
Yeah.
You know, like, you know, Chaskey.
Yeah, like Mount Carmel, Chaskey.
Yeah, Mount Carmel. Yeah. And then you had the, you know, people call the, you know, all the Salzburg Road and shit. Like, they call that the suburbs.
I know what you mean.
They call that the suburbs, but I'm like,
I was near the Swansons and BP side, and everybody like they would always say, oh, Panhills, that, and then you know, I mean, I guess it was kind of like a thing. Like I was like, well, the other side is like they don't ever come over here, and this side don't really ever go over there.
Right.
You really get a mixture of being outside the city,
mm-hmm.
not really depending on what side you're on, being exactly. outside the city,
exactly.
and being suburban. It's
right.
It's like a little mix.
It's definitely mixed, and it's like. If you weren't, you know, if you didn't have, you know, the type of family like that took family vacations, like you would,
yeah.
you know, like I had, bro, I had a friend, bro, that didn't, He ain't taking vacation his whole childhood. The only vacation that he had was Kennywood.
Bro. Kennywood. Bro, Kennywood. Downtown. Downtown. The mall.
The mall.
That's it.
Like, bro.
The park, even.
Skate park. See, look, see. When the skate park opened, bro, I think that was just the you know, turning point, everything. Like everybody just went to the skate park.
Yeah.
And then, you know, I'm saying, rest in peace, boy Todd. Bang.
Yeah, RP Todd.
That's crazy. RP Zap too, I swear.
Dang, Zap, man, that's crazy.
That's wild, bro.
So,
why don't smoke my first cigarette with Todd. Facts, hey yo, I swear, I smoked my first cigarette with Todd, yo. That was my first and last time ever smoking a cigarette, bro. I swear to God, bro, it was a freaking Camel. I'm like, what is these?
Yep,
I'm like, you ain't got no Newport? Like, I'm like, black people, you know what I'm saying, usually smoke Newport. I'm like,
Todd was different.
What is Camel? He smoked Camels and Mavericks and Marlboros. I'm like, yeah. I said, hey, Phil. But.
That's
like a
grown man.
So, life was cool growing up in Penn Hills.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? You're doing your thing. So, what inspired you to be involved in music?
Man, for real. Just. I will say, listen, my dad, for real. It's like, you know, because growing up, he was in college, you know. Him and my mom, you know, were together since they was in seventh grade.
That's what's up. That's a beautiful thing to hear.
They still together to this day.
Till this day?
24. They just celebrated their 24 years.
24 years?
Of marriage.
All right, shout out to Thompsons, right? Mm-hmm. Shout out to the Thompsons. Mm-hmm. Hope you get to watch this at the crib, you know what I'm saying? Keep going.
And, unfortunately, you know, my dad wasn't there when I was born. Stuff like that because he was in college. He was still finishing up his senior year in college. So I was born in April and he didn't graduate until May. So, you know, I was born April 10th. So he didn't come home until like a month or so later. So, you know, it was just, you know, and he was gone every weekend doing shows and stuff. Him and my uncle, because him and my uncle.
Doing shows, uncles, what you mean?
They were doing shows. I'm talking.
What you mean? Like.
Doing performing, going.
Rapping, DJing.
Because my uncle was the DJ. And my dad was a rapper, and my other uncle was the rapper. And they had a group it was called High Low Productions back in the day. This was back when Pittsburgh hip hop was like
Mailman and all that?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. You know, so they were doing shows every weekend, you know, going back and forth to Ohio, going back and forth to, you know, Michigan, Chicago, stuff like that, you know, and it's like, you know, seeing that. Being around my dad, you know, like my dad used to take me and my little brother to the studio with him, and I would go see him perform and stuff like that at a just bro young.
What was that like seeing your dad in the music industry like that? Like going to the studio and seeing your dad perform and people like reacting to it?
I mean, it was a beautiful thing, and it was more so of a learning experience too, because like when I was in the studio with him, I would just, you know, I would literally just be looking at him. And looking at the engineer, just do stuff like he. And this was back when like you know all the technology we got now, like they didn't have none of that. It was just, you know, strictly you had a turntable, you had a big soundboard, and you had the mixer.
Yeah.
So I was just, you know, I was watching him, you know, play the keyboard, and you know he was making the beats on a little beat pad, and then he had the turntables. He would add the scratches into the turn. I was like. I used to just be like, yo, like, this is crazy. Like, I want to do this one day.
Like science class.
Bro, swear, it was like, bro, straight science. And then, as I got older, you know, my dad really, you know, started showing me the ropes, started teaching me how to write, started teaching me how to, you know, format verses, and, you know, just how to, you know, align my verses and align my punchlines and stuff like that.
All right, so your pops had you writing, had you learning about song structure, would you say?
Right.
Can you let the people know at home watching what how do you structure a song? What's the typical structure of a song? How does one go about that? Let's say I don't know, but I want to be a rapper. I want to be like Seth.
Right.
Where do I start when it comes to making a song? How do I structure it?
So basically, you know, find a beat that you like and your choice, right? Then listen to the beat, you know, get the flow of the beat, you know, just see how everything, you know, how the beat aligns, you know, because like, if the beat is like, if the beat comes off like real strong at first, like when it first comes on, then you know nine times out of ten, you know, like your brain, like that light bulb will go off in your head, and then, you know, like you'll suddenly start to get the urge to just, okay, cool, you bop your head, and then, you know, stuff start pops up in your head.
Mm-hmm.
Then that's when, you know, you get your hook going, cool. Once you got your hook down pat, bam, got your hook down pat.
How many hooks go into a song?
It all depends. I like having two hooks in a song.
Okay.
But it just all depends on the structure of the beat.
Okay.
You know, and it all depends on how long the beat is, you know, because nowadays, you know, I noticed that people have shorter attention spans.
It's like
the game has changed tremendously.
It has.
It was back then, songs were literally 3 minutes, 50 seconds, up to 4 minutes. And you listen to the whole song.
Three verses, three hooks. Bridge.
That's what it was. And that's what a hit song was. Now, today, niggas just go in and punch and punch it. Sorry.
Straight verse.
Just straight verse. No hook.
Or verse, hook. That's it. Or verse.
No. Now hook, it's just, yeah. No. Now it's just verse. They don't have no hook. They just rap. They just punch. People just punch in and they freestyle.
I like long songs. I'm not going to lie to you.
I mean, look, that's cool. You know, freestyling and punching in is cool because everybody has different methods of a hip hop and rap.
Yeah.
But, you know, as an artist, as a professional, you know, because there's a difference between people who do it, you know, like people who rap, say that they rap, and, you know, oh yeah, I rap, oh yeah, I do this, I do that, but then, and there's a difference between that and a professional. Like, if you're a professional, you know, you outline everything that you do, from your songs, from, you know, the song that you want on your albums, from, you know, it's just like, you know, it's like writing down your goals.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? It's just like, you got an album coming out, right?
Talk about it.
You sign with a label. They said, okay, cool, we got you for two albums. Mm-hmm. You got to drop an album every year between those two albums. So you got to drop, so you get two albums, right?
Yeah.
So that's an album for 2 years. You got one album 1 year, and then next year, you got another album. So you got to write down your structure for that album, for those albums. So you gotta know what you want to talk about, mm-hmm. what the album's going to be based off of, and then you gotta come with the material.
Mm-hmm.
It's just, you know, like, some things come naturally to other people than it does others. You know, some people have to, you know, work harder than other people have to, you know. Mm-hmm. Like, everybody has a gift.
Mm-hmm.
But it's just, you know, it's up to you to, you know, unleash that gift. You feel what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So with me, I noticed that, you know, I'm different. You know, people say, dang, Seth, your ad-libs are strong. You know, like, your hook game is strong. Like, your verse, like, and so now, you know, I know how to align everything. Hook, verse, hook. And then, you know, like, if the beat's long enough, I can add, like, another little 4 to 8 bars onto it. And then song's over.
Mm-hmm.
On to the next one. And that's how I structure all my songs. Okay. That's how I structure everything. Like, it's just, you know, it's an art.
That it is.
At the end of the day, you know, you have to study. Mm-hmm. You have to, you know, look. You have to look into everything.
Mm-hmm.
Everything has to be detail oriented,
mm-hmm.
and you have to, you know, you have to have a why. Like, why are you rapping? Like,
I'm
why?
Glad
are
you said that.
Why are you doing this?
And when I say this, I don't want you to think I'm taking a jab at you.
No,
taking
good.
A shot at you.
Good.
So I'll be seeing you go on your Facebook rant sometimes, man. Yeah. Like, sometimes I'm DJing, I'm not DJing. I'm rapping, I'm not rapping.
Mm-hmm.
I'm modeling, I'm not modeling. I'm doing this, I'm not doing this. What? Can you let the people know what it's like to go through the motions like that as an artist? Because I'm aware the customer service business is a business where people have to buy into your service, right? Your craft. Right.
Exactly.
And I'm also aware that being an artist, your art is made on you and your own creativity and your own thought process. But the industry is driven on sales, which derive from how people perceive your personal expression of yourself.
Right.
So could you give people some advice when it comes to going through the motions, or why you may have felt this way one day versus the next day, when it comes to dealing with people perceiving you through your artistic expression, whether it be DJing, rapping, writing, modeling, fashion, all that stuff?
Okay. I'm glad you said that. So my advice to, you know, anybody who's, you know, just, you know, wanting to do anything, It's just, you know, stick to what you know. You know, you can get outside your comfort zone, but you have to, you know, master what you know. You know, master what you're good at.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because things don't come easy. You know, they you know, you might see things coming easier to another person. You know, you might be watching, you know, another artist or something like that, and, you know, stuff's just coming, you know, natural to them. Okay, cool. That's them. That's mm-hmm. not you. You can't watch everybody else. You mm-hmm. can't watch everybody's movements. You can't watch, you know, what everybody else is doing. Like, you got to focus on you. And that was my problem. I was looking at, you know, other people, you know, trying to compare, you know, my artistry to their artistry. And like, dang, like, what I got to do to be right there? No. You just got to do what you got to do. Run your race. It's just like, you know, the game in the industry, it's like life. You know, life is a marathon. The industry is a marathon, too. You know?
Mm-hmm.
You dictate how long you're going to be in the game. You dictate how long, you know, you want to make good quality music. You dictate everything. You know, like, you're in control of your own destiny. Like, that's mm-hmm. what I was always taught, and that's what I was always, you know, instilled with. You know, everybody makes mistakes. Everybody, you know, everybody goes through, you know, their trials and their tribulations and everything like that. But it's all about the bounce back. It's all about, you know, you bouncing back and you know, you getting that dirt off your shoulder, you getting that chip off your shoulder, like, okay, cool, I'm gonna tackle this. You know, gotta have discipline. People don't have discipline. You know, people wanna make a, people think that they make a one good song and make one good video and be like, oh yeah, I'm on, somebody gonna sign me. No, it's not how it works.
Talk about it.
Look at Reese Youngin.
Years.
Bro, real deal years, bro. Like, if that doesn't, you know, give you any type of motivation or, you know, shine some light on whatever, mm-hmm. then I don't know what to say, because it's like, yo, like, we, like, everybody thought that he was going to get signed when he was supposed to. That's when he was supposed to get signed. 2016, 2017, like.
Yeah, I remember them. I remember that summer, that dropped Tropical and like Paper Plate and all
bro,
that.
Bro,
killing like, it that whole summer.
And then that's the year that he performed at PH's Penn Hills Homecoming that year.
I ain't go to Homecoming that year. I missed that one.
I saw it on video.
Me too. I went to the one before and the one after.
I saw it on video. I was just like.
Shout out to Erica doing the thing, getting that together. That was hard.
I swear. Hey, I don't know how they got that together, but yeah. they pulled that off, because, man, we've been trying to get. I remember we was trying to get a freaking Pittsburgh artist to perform at our homecoming since freaking 2012. Like, you know what I mean? But yeah, they finally got it done, and mm-hmm. they pulled the necessary strings, and it's just like, you know, everybody got their own gift, man.
Mm-hmm.
You know, do what makes you happy. Like, don't let anybody out here, you know, tell you how to do you. You know, and that was my problem too. Like, everybody, you know, like, it's cool to accept constructive criticism.
Yeah, that it is.
But, you know, you gotta differentiate between constructive criticism and hate. You know, you gotta know, you gotta read between the lines. Mm-hmm. You gotta peek the signs when a person hating on you versus when a person really trying to motivate you and really sees the good in you. You feel what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Like, that's why I don't really, you know, associate myself with certain types of people no more, because, you know, I analyze their body languages, and I analyze their, you know, just their traits, and, you know, like, how they talk to me, and yeah. you know, like, what we talk about and how often we, you know, we talk and stuff like that. And it's just like, you know, I support everybody.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I support you a lot, you support me, you know what I'm saying? And
it's just
like, you know, support goes a long way. You know, mm-hmm. like, you don't have to, you know, it's not always about, oh, you know, you invest into somebody. No. Like, that's one type of support. But the main support is, like,
that's one. It don't always got to be financial.
And that's the problem. People always think that money rules everything. Money is the root of evil, if you ask me. You know, because money can change people. It can, you know, hinder people. And it can ruin people's lives. Like, y'all see all of these celebrities and stuff like that, and it's just like, if these people aren't, you know, motivation to you, then I don't know what y'all are doing. It's just like, people have a funny way of doing things. Like, people be more concerned of celebrities' lives than, you know, their own friends' lives. You know what I mean? Like, they be more worried about what Dirk and Baby and Jada and, you know, Ari and Moneybagg and all them, what they doing, but y'all ain't got nothing. Y'all ain't doing nothing. Y'all still in the same position that y'all was 3-4 years ago. Oh, you think because you got some drip and you, them saying, you Facebook famous that, you know, people don't know the real you? You know what I'm saying? Like, I ain't never had to be Facebook famous. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, it's like, you don't try to impress people. Just be impressive.
What was your fashion inspiration?
Man, my fashion. Fab is my fashion. Look, okay. Fab is my fashion inspiration. He's one of the 3-4 people that I look up to in the industry.
Okay. You know, all right, like, so let's tie this in. Let's tie this in. Your fashion inspiration. And your favorite artist, big and local?
Big and local? My favorite artist, I gotta say Jadakiss, man. Gotta say, it's a tie between Jadakiss, Fab, Jay-Z. Those are my top three. You know, because those are the people that, you know, that I grew up listening to. Oh, and the GOAT, Bow Wow.
Bow Wow, my A.
Bow Wow.
Hey,
like, yo,
hey.
Let's talk about this. Let's talk about this right now, homie. Let's talk about
they don't got songs to their own movies.
Bro. Bow Wow was 12, 13 with $10 million, bro.
He was five.
Five.
On Death Row Records.
On Death Row.
As a 5-year old.
As a 5.
No, hard that.
Bro. Do you not know Bow Wow has owned his own masters since he was 15?
Man, he was when I first started getting introduced.
They had that plan. Him and Jermaine Dupri had that plan that, you know, Jermaine Dupri. This is why Jermaine Dupri is the person that he is because mm-hmm. I don't care what people say about, you know, him, you know, jacking over Mulatto and Rap Game and stuff like that, whatever. But like Jermaine Dupri, he put artists in position to flourish, like mm-hmm. you know, like it's crazy because, you know, I feel like Diddy is a better producer and a better, you know, icon and a better mogul than Jermaine Dupri is. Okay. But I'm never going to discredit what Jermaine Dupri has brought and done for mm-hmm. the game. Like he brought you Bow Wow, the Brat, mm-hmm. them Franchise Boys, mm-hmm. Jagged Edge, he done, like mm-hmm. like the list goes on and on and on. Like, he has produced some of the biggest hits ever. Like Sammy, even though Sammy was a one hit wonder, even it doesn't really matter, but Sammy too.
RIP, didn't Sammy pass recently?
Yes.
Yeah,
yes,
RIP
he did.
Sammy.
Yes, he did. That's crazy.
Bow Wow was my favorite rapper growing up, but especially as being like a little black kid with braids,
man.
And I had the CDs, like I had the Bow Wow CDs.
You was not a fan if you did not have the Bow Wow CDs, you know, and the posters.
You know what I'm saying? Like, my mom gave me a CD player one Christmas. I think I was like 7, 8 years old. She gave me a CD player and she gave me Price of Fame. I'm like, yo, bro, I feel like that
fame,
dude.
Price of Fame album, bro.
I'm sitting here listening to Out of My System by T-Pain, like I'm hurt.
Bro.
Like, I got, like, bro. Somebody, you know what I'm saying, I broke up with some girl on a playground after a kickball game or something.
Duh.
Price of Fame's classic.
That's probably one of Bow Wow's classic albums right there. Like, and people, I don't care what.
The Baby record with Jagged Edge on it?
Because that was him, because the, I don't know if you remember this, but the soundtrack for the movie Hardball, right?
Mm-hmm.
The main single for that one was with Jagged Edge, Sammy, and Bow Wow on it. Bro, that song.
These dudes is crazy. Bro, that can't be stopped.
But that single went double platinum.
Hardball came out like what? Like 03?
That came out, yeah, like 03, 04.
Something like that.
Like, and bro, like, it was like, that's back when, you know, movies had, bro, like, that's when movies had soundtracks. They had soundtracks, like, and that's when, back when, you know, that's when CD Warehouse was open. Like, when you could go get CDs, and you open a CD, and they got a poster and a CD.
Thank you.
I think Chris Brown.
Yes.
Chris Brown's first album, bro.
The Chris Brown album.
The Chris Brown album. It had a poster, and it had a DVD to it. It was called, the DVD was called The Journey.
These artists don't have... Listen, I miss.
If y'all don't do y'all research, bro, I'm look, and I'm telling y'all right now, man. If y'all look, if y'all in the music industry, like, and if y'all, you know, y'all want to rap, y'all want to do this, like, y'all gotta do y'all research, man. Like, y'all just can't just be hopping in the studio and just rapping. Like, y'all gotta know, like, what's really good in the industry. Like, y'all gotta know y'all history.
Man, tangible. I miss tangible content. Like, for example, Larry June and 21 Savage, they came out with photo books for their albums that they
right,
came out
exactly.
with.
Exactly.
You could flip through photos and see the past mm-hmm. few years through pictures.
Exactly.
Or you get, like, a Morgan Freeman to narrate your mixtape with Metro Boomin. Or back then, you get posters, you might get a little medallion. You know, I used to open a cereal box, you might get the Star Wars little spoon dip.
Exactly.
They don't put that in the albums no more.
You open a Lucky Charms box, yeah. man, and you get a freaking sticker, and you get a coupon worth freaking 150 box tops.
Nowadays, all the music is just digital. You don't get a poster, you don't get a shirt, you don't get nothing. You just get the stream and listen to it, which is cool.
And then with these concerts, too. Then with these concerts, it's like, I think, like, they've limited the amount of merch that they can sell. Bro, I remember...
But that counts toward sales now.
And I remember...
Which is crazy.
Bro, and I remember when...
musical sales, like, charting.
Who came here? Oh, I'm trying to think. I forget who came here.
That dude that was performing with the mic and the... shoes and...
Man,
yeah, the fit.
I forget who came here, but... It was a big concert,
mm-hmm.
bro. He had merch, bro, from wall to wall. I'm talking t-shirts, sweatsuits, hats, gloves, mugs, posters.
Tech Nine? I don't think you would go to a Tech Nine concert. Through me being at the station, I ended up at some.
No, you want to know who it was?
Who?
KRS-One. And he performed at Mr. Smalls.
Man, can't
watch. Cause look, that was my first time going to a KRS-One concert, and mm-hmm. when I tell you, bro, that might have been the best experience of my life, bro. Because it's like, that's a hip hop show.
Yeah.
It's a hip hop show.
Real like, deal,
horror. Real deal.
Like KRS-One.
Bro, and
like
it's
one of the godfathers of hip hop.
I've never seen somebody perform like this. I've never seen somebody take control of the crowd the way that they did, and it's just like, you know, the influence that KRS-One has in hip-hop, bro,
mm-hmm.
it's just unreal. Like, bro, he turned that Step Into the World on, right?
Mm-hmm.
He just turned the intro on. Everybody went crazy. Lights was flashing, everything. Beat drop, bro. I'm telling you, bro, we all jumped up in unison, bro. Mm-hmm. I swear, bro, Bro, it was just like, bro, just a shock just went through my body. I was like, yo, what the?
Yeah.
Like, what is this? And then after that, I went to, I don't know if you're familiar with them, you probably are, Camp Lowe.
Heard of them.
Geechee Suede, man. I got a picture with them, man, because my uncle and my dad, they know them.
What era?
This is the 90s. This is late 90s, early 2000s. You know the song?
I think KRS-One talked about him.
You know the song? This is it, what? Buccini falling from the sky, let's get lit, what? From the sky, let's get lit. Bro,
maybe.
You gotta know that song. That song's maybe. A classic right there.
There are so many songs out here in the world. But, moving on, name three choices that you made that improved your life.
Put myself first.
That's a good one.
Investing in myself.
That's a good one.
And time management.
Can you expound on one of those three?
Well, time management is, I'm gonna tell you this, like, you know, because I was in the process of, you know, just, you know, finding my sound. Like, this was before I made that Mr. Poppin'. So I was just, you know, just figuring out what route I'm gonna take.
Mm-hmm.
Just figuring out how, you know, I'm gonna make my mark in the city, and, you know, and globally. You know, I started thinking it was short term and then long term, and then I just, you know, found my niche. Like, you know, I was punching in the studio, this, then the third, that wasn't working out. So, you know, I finally, you know, managed my time to sit down and really write,
mm-hmm.
and really just, you know, pick my own brain. And just really, you know, sit down, like, really, really, really write. And then I just, you know, manage my time. Like, you know, just with booking stuff, I'm not booking, double booking myself anymore. You know, I had myself on a schedule. Everything's on a schedule now.
Structured.
You know, everything's structured. You know, I'm, okay, cool. I got work this day. Work. And then a weekend, cool. I can have time for whatever I want to have time for. If I want to go to the studio, go to the studio. If I want to, you know, go get a drink, you know what I'm saying? Do this, whatever. Mm-hmm. It's just like, you know, I'm not, you know, throwing all of my eggs in one basket anymore. I'm just, you know, I'm taking everything a step at a time. Okay, cool. You know, people were telling me, like, for the longest time ever, Seth, you need to drop a video. Seth, you need to drop a video. You need to do this. You need to do that. But I feel like it wasn't my time to drop a video at that time because I wasn't ready. You know, it wasn't time for me to, you know, I wasn't in content with myself. And I wasn't, you know, I wasn't where I needed to be mentally.
That's real.
And, you know, just physically. Like, I wasn't where I wanted to be. But now, you know, I finally sat myself down and really got myself together. I'm really like, okay, Seth, let's really do this. Like, let's really put everything on the line. Put everything on the table. Let everything out. And let's just go forward with this. Let's do it. Like, and now it's just, you know, I feel like I got the monkey off my back now. And now I'm just, you know, I'm just, everything is just coming hand in hand. Everything is just coming together the way that I want it to. So, you know, everything is just, everything's all about timing. Everything's all about God's timing, you know, like, and it's, that was my big thing. Like, I wanted stuff done the way that I wanted it to be done and when I wanted it to be done. But, you know, when you got a good, strong relationship with God, you know, God always comes on time. And, you know, I just felt like his timing was better than mine.
Yeah, like my grandma always says, God's grace, God's will, God's time.
Exactly.
What's meant to be is meant to be. Exactly. Like DJ Alex Rivera told me one time, shout out to him, whoever's meant to be there will be there.
Mm-hmm.
And whoever's not meant to be there, they ain't gonna be there.
You're not.
You know what I'm saying?
You're not. And you have to be okay with, you know, allowing people to exit your life. You know, because, you know, okay, cool. It's like,
it sucks sometimes.
It sucks. It definitely sucks does sometimes
because like, you really don't want to do that.
You don't want to do that and you don't want to be that type of person. But
you might not be being a negative person by doing that, but just knowing what you thought or what could have been, it's not that no more. It could really be conflicting. Like, yo, this is my boy, or like, yo, it's my homegirl.
Right.
Or this is my girl, or this is, you know, my cousin. And you really got to, like, just, you know, keep him, do what's best for you. Let's say that.
And it's just, you know, when you're growing and, you know, you outgrow people.
Yeah.
And, you know, like when you grow, you know, certain people aren't going to like the way that you grow. They're not going to like the route that you're taking because they're so used to you know, being with them, being behind them, doing whatever, you know, they want to do versus what you want to do. You know what I mean? So when you fully grow and you know, you're like, you're living out your purpose, people get mad. They're going to get mad.
All right, man. So before we get up out of here, you got any shout outs you want to give? Where can the people tune in? Where can they follow you? Check out your music, tap in with you, book you to DJ a party. And what can we expect from you in the future?
Look, man, I just want to give a shout out, man, to everybody that support me, man. Everybody that's on this live right now. Shout out to you. Just for, you know, reaching out to me and, you know, just let me come in here and, you know, share my story, you know, just and chop it up with you, you know what I'm saying? Because we haven't had a conversation like this in a long time. So, you know, this was definitely needed.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? Outside of the hookah.
Bro, for real. They don't know about the hookah, though.
They don't.
But, I also want to give a shout out to, you know, just give a shout out to 40 Gang, DJ Bricks. Give a shout out, you know what I'm saying? My homie Tatum Man, TDM, you know what I'm saying? You know how we rock blood. Just give a shout out to everybody that support me, man. And I got a project out right now, Seffy De Niro's, out on all platforms right now. Go cop that, go get that, man. Got a video dropping. It's my lead single from the project, Step It Up, dropping next Friday. My release party for the project's next Friday also. It's free. Like I said, F-R-E-E.
Free 99.
Free 99.
No,
it's free tax. 99. No tax. Free 99. Next week, Wilson's Night Out in Swissville. Come out, have a good time. You feel me? Celebrate. You know what I'm saying? We're going to rock out. And yeah, got video dropping next Friday. till I step it up. And got another project. I'll probably drop another project probably, if not February, then around my birthday time, April, mm-hmm. April, May-ish.
Okay.
You know, so I'm going to probably drop another video too in between that time. So, mm-hmm. yeah, that's basically it. Man, we just gonna continue to ride this train. We're gonna continue to rock it out.
Hey man, well, we appreciate you, man. Good Sefi, Uncle Sefi, DJ Sef, Sef to Death, aka Sef, for coming through to the Future Flavors yeah! show.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I appreciate you, brother, man.
You too. It's been a pleasure.
Yes, sir. It's been a pleasure.
Get out, told us, motherfucker. Glock 13, lightning. This don't make me up it. Double to the jam, blue tips, yeah they hot, blowing like a fan. Talking like a gangster, but really he a fan. All that pussy for the neck, nigga you a ham. I don't really fuck with niggas, only thuggin' with the clan. Honey, I don't really fuck with niggas, only thuggin' with the clan. Came from the bottom, all I had was a nigga. And yeah, my bitch the baddest, guess I got a way to pick. I want this shit forever, ain't no letting up. All gas, no brakes, gotta step it up. I'm the king of the court, nigga, check it up. You wanna gamble with his life, nigga, bet it up.
She want me to not just ride with a bestie. Told her, set it up. She hit me like it's a go. Told her, bet it up. I'm pimpin' bitches, digging bitches down. Only kept her on my roster cause that head good.
She want me to pull on her head, grip her neck and run my finger through it. Met her in the hood, she was shooting dice. Project baby moving low, she go savvy, what's the price? I'm like, baby, what you want? I got what you need. She like, damn, this shit is fire. Let me get a couple peas. So I pull up to the chop, I put you on. Yeah, we hiring. Told her I can flutter with the lows, I always got that fire. I need Nemo for a Kwame, need Kobe for a P. All around hustle, I get to the cheese.
Definitely, nigga. Cause I'ma definitely make it happen, yeah.